Hey everybody, thanks for being here. Today we're fishing near the mouth of the Columbia River for Fall Chinook. And then we've got some guest video from the High Roller Lingcod Tournament on the California Dawn in the San Francisco Bay Area. Now if you want to learn how to catch more fish, stay tuned. I'm Justin Wolf, and this is Angler West Television. Today we're at Astoria, Oregon, near the mouth of the Columbia River, hopefully home to the world's largest salmon run. But so far this year, the fall run Chinook have been a little slow to show themselves. We're with guide Steve Leonard, who's fishing with Steve and James Lynch of Procure, Jason Hambly of Procure, and Josh Cooper from Cousins Tackle. This year's fishing so far has been spotty, so today, every bite counts.
See, we ran across the river here through a ditch, and we're at the Washington side below the Astoria Magdo Bridge. We're gonna fish them on the flats here. These fish like to hang on these bigger tides, so we're gonna be fishing about 28 to 30 feet of water seems to be best for us the last few days. And as the tide slacks up, we're gonna slide out to a little bit deeper water where they like to school up and kind of move out in that deeper water. So we're gonna make a pass down through here and see what we can come up with. Already shown some fish down there. A lot of them are on the bottom. Some are suspended just a little bit. I use a lot of frozen herring, especially on these big tides. I just like them because the main thing for catching salmon down here is having a good flash in your bait. So I've taken frozen herring last night, thawed them out this morning, put them in the Procure's liquid brine and bite. And I have one I use the powder also, and another brine I have with some salt, sea salt in it. And it seemed to be really, really works very well. It kind of firms them up. There's one of the baits right here. You can see the scales in here. They're all set. They don't come off. A lot of the fresh baits in these bigger tides, the scales will come off. Everybody has their own preference, but this is what works for me. And you can see how shiny this bait is. So hopefully it attracts in some of those big kings that we can hook up today for you. So today I'm fortunate enough to have enough rods running, so we're running six rods so we can stagger different depths to find out which one's hot. I'm running a Shimano Dakota reel that has a line counter on it. It seems to be really works well for me because I know exactly where my lines are at. So we're going to suspend those front ones off the bottom. We still have a pretty good drag on the line, so I'm running about 30, 32 feet. So they're going to be about 4 feet off the bottom. Then these back rods, we're going to run them right on the bottom, 1 to 2 cranks off the bottom. So it kind of gives that option to find out where these fish are at and cover that whole water column. Okay, we made a pass down here to 30 feet. Tide's starting to slack up and not much going on, but there's a few boats out in the deeper water where I've been fishing when this tide starts to change. And there's been a few fish already caught, a little snap of the bite going off. So we're gonna move out in a little bit deeper water here and see what we can come up with. Okay, 30 in the middle, guys, 28 on the bow. Just got our first hook up here. James, that nice one on. Our second pass down through here in some deeper water, so looks like it might be a Chinook here. Go your right, go your right. Lift the rod, lift the rod. Fish in the boat. First one of the morning so far. The bite just coming on, the tide just starting to come in, so get our lines back in the water and get another one. So we're running a 60-foot line here, 58 to 60 feet. We got this fish. They're suspended in here, mid-column, about 30 feet down. When this thing starts flooding in, these fish will come off the bottom from the big outgoing tide and it'll just suspend themselves. So you just gotta find that right number where they're at. So this in here is a little bit deeper in the back and we got hooked up, so now we know kind of what we need to put the other rod.
Okay, I hope you're enjoying today's fishing from the Columbia River and that you're learning a few things that might help you catch more fish. Now, if you're setting up your own boat with rods, what you don't want to do is to have four or six rods that are all identical. Most guys like to spread things out a little bit with some 10.5-foot rods, some 9'6" rods with different weights and powers that are going to help you handle the different weights that you might be using, plus spread your gear out more. Now, Cousins makes a series of rods that are specifically designed for this Columbia River fishery. They're called the Columbia Composite Series. For example, we've got the CC 1056 TG here, a 10.5-foot rod, and the CC 955 TG, a 9'6" rod. Now, these two rods are going to give you the ability to spread out and to handle everything that the Columbia River can throw at you. I'm sure you'll be very happy with these rods. Now, when you go into a store to purchase a rod, you want to make sure that you're getting one that was built correctly, and you'd be surprised how many rods out there are not built correctly. Now, here's what you do. First thing you want to look for is the spine. So take the tip part on a two-piece rod or a one-piece rod and set it right on the table or the floor and gently roll it till you find the stiffest point of the rod. Now on this rod, that's right there, okay? So this cousin's rod was built correctly because the eyes are lined up with the spine. It's very simple to do. Just roll it, that's soft. You roll it back here, that's stiff, and all the lines are lined up perfectly on the stiff part. Now, if a rod isn't spined correctly, you'll lose some of the power and functionality of the rod. But also, if you're casting with it, every time you cast, your lure is going to go off to the right or to the left, and you'll just be messed up. You're like, how come I can't cast straight? Well, it's good because your rod wasn't spined correctly. So another thing you want to look at with the carbon fiber handles is that it was put on correctly. These carbon fiber woven handles have a right way and a wrong way. If they're put on the right way, the correct way, they won't be slippery. Have you ever heard people complain about these handles being slippery? They're not slippery at all if they're put on correctly. But if it was switched around and put this way, that's slippery. See? So this is correct, this is not correct. The way they're woven tell you how they should be on the rod handle. And so this is going to give you friction, so it won't be slippery. If it was switched around, like this rod was happened to be built incorrectly. This is an old rod that I broke a while ago. This one is slippery, and this one is not. So you'd be surprised. You go into a store, and you start feeling all the rods, and you might get some funny looks, but you're going to find quite a few that are not built correctly. I haven't found a cousin's rod that wasn't built correctly yet, but you know, these are made by human beings, so they can make mistakes. So just give it a quick check and make sure you're getting a rod that was built correctly. Now, let's go back and catch some more salmon.
Welcome back to the mouth of the Columbia River, where losing a fish is a real heartbreaker, especially this year as fishing has been tougher than usual at the mouth of the Columbia, otherwise known as the Buoy 10 fishery. The guide Steve Leonard has tracked down our first fish of the day, and now we're looking for more. Steve has decided to make a short run to take advantage of the tide and hopefully intercept some fresh fish.
Okay, we made a run downriver here. We're just off of buoy 12. We're actually on the Washington side off the A jetty at the mouth of the Walker Channel. Water temp got there around 68, 69 degrees, almost 69 up there where we're at. So we dropped down here, the water's 63 degrees, hoping to catch a fresh batch of fish coming in. A lot more activity down here in the anchovies, and hopefully these fish will come in here and tuck in behind this jetty in this calmer water and hang out for a little bit. We'll get some hookups. So
a lot of birds
are feeding in here. We got a humpback whale just kind of porpoised over here. So hopefully we can find some fish in here and get some hookups.
We thought we were on bottom here, and we just keep ticking all these bait. We have so many anchovies in the river that the rod's just going crazy the whole time. So it's hard sometimes to tell between the bottom and the bait, but we're in. You look on your fish finder and you're in so many bait that it's pretty obvious what it is.
Yeah, I'm running six rods today. I have a bigger boat here, so I like to have longer rods up the back, which is a 10-64, it's a 10.5-foot rod, and a 9-foot-6 in the middle, so I have a good spacing, and then 10.5 on the front. Some guys have a shorter boat, they don't really need that longer rod in the back, so they can run a 9.3 out the back, or the 9.65 with a 10-6 in the front. Everybody has their own preference. The 9.65 is more of a stiffer rod I like for the heavier leads we're running here, and it just seems to work really good for us down here in this fishery. And then I just have different size leads I put on for dragging the bottom. For, you know, fishing suspended fish, I'll use the same size lead so my counters are all the same. But when you're fishing the bottom, you want different size leads. 4-ounce increments, usually a difference. So when they're on the bottom, you're not getting tangled up or they're all in the same spot. It just gives more of a separation. Seems to work very well for that.
Here we are.
Kind of an evening bite here. Tide's starting to change, starting to flood. It's going to quit here. We're in a tough day of fishing up here on the Columbia River. Ready.
Go.
Good job, Josh.
down here at Buoy 10, mouth of the Columbia River, biggest salmon run in the world. This fish could be going anywhere from Idaho to right here locally. Beautiful fish.
Welcome back. Now up next, we're going to go down to California and do some lingcod fishing. But first, I want to show you how to make tartar sauce, because if we're lingcod fishing, we're going to need some tartar sauce. And after we get back, I'm going to show you how to make fried fish that's light and crispy and not soggy and mushy. So tartar sauce is basically a combination of mayonnaise and sweet relish, plus whatever other ingredients you want to add to give the taste that you want. So the way I like to make tartar sauce is real simple. Just a scoop or two of mayonnaise, depending on how much I need. A little bit of sweet relish. I usually think about twice as much mayonnaise as sweet relish. So I put two scoops of mayonnaise in there. I'm gonna put one spoonful of relish. Now one thing that I really like that might be a little unusual in tartar sauce is horseradish, but I like horseradish. So we're gonna throw a little horseradish in there. A little bit of hot sauce. Sea salt and pepper. Mix that up and you've got really good tartar sauce. Now let's go down to California, where Tangler West Pro Team member Tom Amerson took his camera out on the California Dawn and got us some video of the High Roller Lingcod Tournament. And when we come back, I'm going to show you how to fry fish that you're really going to love.
At the end of the day, you're going to pick your biggest three, and it's going to be based on three lingcod limit. Heaviest limit wins, second heaviest limit gets second place. So first place is probably going to be like $2,000, second place is $900. Rock cod, it's a full limit of rock cod, and it's only rockfish count. Rockfish, capazone, halibut don't count, sharks don't count. We're going to do a bait stop. If you want to use the live bait, you got to participate. Lingcod don't count during the bait stop. If you get a keeper ling then, we're gonna toss it back. So don't catch a lingcod then. Don't be trying to sandbag. You gotta have good sportsmanship. No getting in the fish box. If you open the fish box, you're disqualified, you lose your money. If you trade fish with a buddy, you're out. If you do something unsportsmanlike, like Rich would try to do to me here, make me lose a big fish, that's not good. So don't do that. We've never had issues like that on this trip, but sportsmanship counts, so, and have a good time.
So today we'll be going up the Marin Coast. I'm gonna try and get some altitude this morning. We're gonna look towards Point Reyes. First stop in the morning will be bait. We're gonna head to San Francisco, fish Pier 45 bait dock, get some anchovies. Then from there, we're gonna make another stop. We're gonna try and jig some smaller bait, put them in the tank, do a community bait stop, and then after that, it'll be pretty much a free-for-all with how guys are fishing, whether it be bars, swim baits, frozen baits, any way you can catch a lingcod, that's how we're gonna do it from there on up. But, this morning's definitely gonna be all about catching some bait, fill the tank. Makes a big difference, everybody fishing uniform, and that's how we do it over here. Try and get everybody on the same page and work out some good bait and hopefully turn it into a whole bunch of wings by the end of the trip.
All right, so we're getting ready to go catch some bait right now. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna use these P-Line sabiki rigs. They're made with fish skin. They got the mylar, some shininess to them that the bait are gonna hold on to. So out of the package, it's kind of neat about them. They're already wound up, ready to go, so they're not a tangled mess. So what happens is you got one side with the barrel swivel that you're gonna tie your main line to, and then the bottom already has a safety snap on it with the barrel swivel. So you just, all you do is unload that, put your weight on, whatever size you need, and it's ready to be fished.
This is the new 14 ounce swim head. It's the 9-inch swim bait made by Fishfield. So what's unique about this is you can fish it a couple different ways. This is for trolling here, this is for jigging. You can put a bottom hook on, probably for trolling, not so much for jigging, but we're gonna make it fairly weedless today, or rockless. We'll put a hook on here on the back, like that. And what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna take a zip tie and put it through the actual meat of the swim bait to keep that straight on there. It's a 14 ounce. They come in a few different sizes. This is the only color we have right now, but we'll start matching them up with Fishfield swim baits. Chartreuse, rainbow trout, squid, kind of a perch right there. Then we get into our Fishfield jigs and assist hooks. These are new too. These are the titanium rainbow hooks. Extra strong, really nice. These bags are really sweet for a party boat trip like this. As you can see over here, this is all the guys' gear behind me. And digging through that throughout the day is going to be really tough. So I'm all organized. I have everything right in front of me. And just cut down on wasted time. These bags are great. They have three different sizes. And you just put all your jigs, all your lures right there so you have it right in front of you when you're fishing.
So I'm rigging up a big frozen mackerel here. Got these at the supermarket. They're just giant, giant fish. Got an octopus hook in the head, a treble hook in the back, and I'm gonna drop that down and mooch it right off the rocks and see what happens.
The San Francisco Bay Area has really been kicking out some great lingcod and rockfish lately. Now, when you get yourself some fish, you want to be able to cook it so it tastes great. There's lots of ways to cook fish. You don't have to fry fish, but I'm going to show you today how to fry fish so it's nice and crispy and light and not all soggy and gross. Now, what I've got here, this is actually halibut, but you can do this with halibut, rockfish, lingcod. Just, we can fry anything, as you know. If you know anything that's fried can taste good, right? But this is some good fresh lingcod brought back from Winter Harbor, Qualicum River's Winter Harbor. So first step is to have good dry fish. This hasn't been sitting in water. It hasn't been soaking in water. It's been cleaned, rinsed, and dried with paper towels very well. So it's a nice dry fish. And to make it even more dry, I'm going to dredge it in flour. So we'll take a few pieces, dredge it in the flour. That's going to get it nice and dry. And then place it in the egg wash. You can use a fork or whatever, but I just like using my fingers. Just get it over with. It's more efficient, faster, easier. Get it nice and covered with egg. This is just a couple eggs beaten up. Nothing to it. Don't need to add milk or anything. Okay, take your egg-covered fish and drop it in your breadcrumbs. These are panko, Japanese-style breadcrumbs. You could also use Italian-style breadcrumbs, or even ground-up Ritz crackers are really good. Whatever breadcrumbs you're using, you want to make sure you've got a nice, even coating on them. So just roll those around in there. Simple as that. Now I'm going to rinse my fingers and put them in the grease. Okay, I've got clean fingers now, and we're ready to start the frying. Now, I've got a regular deep fryer here, but you don't have to have a deep fryer. You can use a big saucepan or a frying pan. Now, if you're using a frying pan, just make sure that you turn your fish and cook the fish evenly on both sides. And if you're using thick chunks of fish, you might have to turn it on all four sides. That's a little more work, but it'll work fine. Now, the deep fryer, one little key is to never put fish into a dry basket. So dip that down to the oil and get your basket oily so your fish doesn't stick. Now, here's our breaded fish ready to go. Don't ever overload your basket, just enough so there's a little space around each piece of fish. In this case, five pieces is gonna be just perfect. And then I'm gonna drop it into the oil pretty quickly and shake it around a little bit so the oil and the fish gets mixed around and it won't stick to the basket, and that's really important. So I like the way that looks right there. I'm gonna pull it out. Now, what a lot of people would do at this point would be to dump this onto paper towels, and that's the worst mistake you can make. You want air to get around that fish and just let it drip naturally, and that'll give you that nice crispy, crunchy fish that you're looking for. So a cookie drying rack, or I don't really know what to call it, but something you would dry or cool cookies on, is what I like to use. So we'll lay it out on there. Oil is able to drip down onto the paper towel that's under the rack, but that right there is going to keep your fish from getting mushy. That's a big key. So, got nice hot fish right out of the oil. A little bit of tartar sauce. Super crunchy.
perfect every time. The oil using is just plain old vegetable oil. You can use peanut oil if you want. A lot of people like to do that, but just plain old vegetable oil works fine. Now, let's go back to the Bay Area and catch some more lingcod.
We've gone out the Golden Gate aboard the California Dawn, captained by James Smith, for the annual High Roller Lingcod Tournament. A combination of jigs, swim baits, live and dead bait are being used to hopefully catch the largest lingcod, which this year is worth $2,000.
Oh, yeah.
Big dog.
Got the hook set on that one. Nice. Pumping, look at that.
He's not hooked all sideways.
I see.
Here he is! Here he is!
Color!
Oh, nice one.
Yeah. I need a 16 tag.
16 tag. Ooh.
Okay, well, getting my hook on the bait.
Oh, Jack's mouth.
Yeah, sabiki this up last week.
Uh-huh. Nice, I'm gonna inhale that thing, I bet.
We'll see if it works.
Let's.
I like two treble hooks.
That's a toad. Look at that.
Congratulations to Dave Galt for winning this year's High Roller Lingcod Tournament. Hey, thanks for watching today's episode. You know, without the support of the sponsors, the show would not be possible. So please thank them when you can. Now, get out there and do some great fishing.